Things that defy explanation. There's non-scientific circumstances as well where God is working in everyday life in particular ways, and we ask God these questions, such as, why do you do things this way? Well, what is your intention in doing this? Why are you allowing this to go for so long? Or why did you do this to this person? So there are things in the Bible that we read that certainly where we question God and ask Him, why did you do it this way? It doesn't make sense to us. But one of the situations and circumstances that doesn't make sense from a human perspective and the way that God reveals Himself is found in Matthew chapter 1 regarding the birth of Jesus Christ. The circumstances under which He was born, not just the political aspect, because the Roman Empire was in control. So they were in control of the Jewish people. But I'm talking more specifically about the way that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the eternal Son of God, would come into this world. Think about this. In Matthew chapter 1, we have a circumstance that we just read about where there's a man named Joseph who is betrothed to this girl named Mary. There go my notes. That doesn't make sense either. That's all right. So he's betrothed to this girl by the name of Mary. Now what's interesting about this is a betrothal in Jewish times usually happened at a very young age where families would decide that this person was going to marry this person. Imagine doing that, right? You know, they may look cute when they're young, but when they're like teenagers and older, you're like, man, you're ugly, I don't want to marry you, okay? So I'd ask for a refund for my dowry. But we see that happening in scriptures is that they would be betrothed, they would be engaged early, and when they get older, that's when they end up getting married. So here is a man named Joseph who has every intention of marrying Mary. Everything is going well, but all of a sudden this news comes to her, that news comes to the fact that she is pregnant and she's with child. Now ask yourself this question. Joseph does not know yet that what is inside of her is of the Holy Spirit, because that's why he ends up having his dream. But Joseph, he finds out that this girl that he was supposed to marry is pregnant. And he's thinking to himself, certainly I'm not the father. Who is the father of this child? What is going on here? Now think for a second, if you were Joseph and you were in his shoes, what would you do? Folks, I want you to think about something. It's just not as easy as it is in our culture where we say, well, you did this to me, I'm going to write up some divorce papers, forget it, and it's over. You have to think about the fact that culturally, there are families involved. There are reputations involved. It's an Eastern culture. It's a shame-oriented culture. So Joseph, in his mind, he's thinking to himself, you know what, she has done this to me, she has betrayed me, how dare she do this, I am going to make a public spectacle of her. But notice what Joseph decides to do. Joseph decides he doesn't want this drama, he's not going to do this to her. Look at verse 19, it says, then Joseph being her husband, look at the next set of words, being a just man. I think that's very key, and I think that's very important. He says, but being a just man and not wanting to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. Don't you wish all divorces were like that, right? And if you look at our world today, divorces are messy, they're crazy, there's tempers that flare, there are people that are angry, but Joseph understood the implications. Quite possibly, he loved this woman, but yet he knew that this was in her life, and he did not want to make a public example of her, because he was a just man. In this passage this morning, I want to show us how God was able to convince Joseph that the next steps that he needed to take were not from earthly circumstances, they were completely from God. And just in the midst of Joseph giving up and saying, forget this, I don't want to have anything to do with it, God comes down and fulfills a purpose in Joseph's life. Look at verse 20 to 21. First thing we're going to look at this morning is this, is that there is a purpose revealed. There is a purpose revealed. Look at verse 20. But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. This angel of the Lord is quite possibly Gabriel, because he appears in all of the narratives regarding the birth of Jesus Christ. For instance, Luke 1:19, the Bible says, and the angel answered and said to him, I am Gabriel, who stands in the presence of God and was sent to speak to you and to bring you these glad tidings. Luke 1:26, now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth. So imagine this for a second. Joseph is contemplating, What am I going to do? This is going to scar my reputation. This is going to scar her reputation. Our families are going to find out what this is doing. When we are walking around in our communities, people are going to be talking about us. Folks, people in communities talking about other people is not a new thing. It's always happened. Sinners will always act like sinners. And since Genesis chapter 3, human beings have done a very good job of sinning. And here we find this man, Joseph. He goes to sleep, but the Lord appears to him in a dream. And what does he say to him? Now, if I was Joseph, I'm thinking to myself that God is going to come and approve of my decision. Joseph, yeah, I feel for you, man. You know, here you were, saving up all your money, you were getting everything ready, and Mary did this to you, man. I completely understand. Do away with her, man. I'll get you somebody else. I'll find you a better wife for you. But notice what ends up happening in God's purpose is being revealed. This angel comes to him and says, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary, your wife. Now, wait a minute. God, I want to put her away privately, okay? I understand what she's done. If she's messed up, you know, that's fine. But I don't want to take this on. But this angel comes to her and says, don't be afraid. And notice the terminology that he uses for Joseph. He could have just said, Joseph, don't do this. But he says, Joseph, son of David. Why is this important? Because the term son of David was to show that Joseph, first of all, was from the lineage of David. Joseph, by the way, was not the physical father of Jesus. He was only in a legal sense. But here's what Matthew, the gospel writer of this book, is trying to show us, is that Jesus Christ is truly the Messiah that was promised in the Old Testament. If you read the Gospel of Matthew over and over again, it is replete with quotes from the Old Testament to show the Jewish people that Jesus Christ is truly the Son of God. And so therefore, Jesus' royal right into the Davidic line came by Joseph. Over and over again in the Old Testament, we see David, a shepherd, a king, leading the armies of Israel, the people of Israel. Matthew is trying to show his Jewish listeners, look at this man here that's going to be coming from the loins of David. He is your Messiah. And Joseph, you have an important task in this, in protecting Mary, because this is something special. Something else is that more than likely Joseph was not aware of the miraculous conception until he was notified by the angel. So Joseph, in an Eastern context, Eastern culture, finds out that this woman that he's about to be married to is pregnant, and he is absolutely fearful. Look at this quote by a gentleman by the name of Harry Emerson. He says this about fear. He says, "Fear imprisons, faith liberates. Fear paralyzes, faith empowers. Fear disheartens, faith encourages. Fear sickens, faith heals. Fear makes useless, faith makes serviceable." What was God trying to do? God was trying to calm his nerves. God was trying to tell him, it's okay. This is not normal. This is outside of the realm of what is normal. And I'm doing this in a special way to bring about God's glory through the fact that Mary is going to have this child. You know what else I've noticed about this narrative is this, is that the aspect of being afraid was a common theme with the men and women God used throughout history. Have you ever thought about that? Fear was a common theme throughout history in the men and women that God used. How many of you have ever been fearful of something? Raise your hand. We just lost sleep at night, right? Every one of us are. It may not be a circumstance like this. It might be finding out, you know, you may not have your job tomorrow, or something financial, or some health crisis that has come into our life. Every single one of us has had those fearful moments, sleepless nights, things that have consumed us. But this is the same thing that is happening to Joseph. And here's something about fear. When it challenges us, is that God always uses men and women who have been in these circumstances where he's turned their fear into faith. Let me share with you a couple of them that are seen as the pinnacle of heroes in the scriptures. Let's look at, first of all, Moses. God comes to Moses and says, you're going to go into Egypt and rescue the people of Israel. You're going to lead them out of Egypt. And you remember what happens, right? He's making excuse after excuse after excuse. Look at Exodus chapter 3, verses 11 through 14. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? So he said, I will certainly be with you, and this shall be a sign to you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, then you shall say to the children of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Isn't it interesting that whenever we read about Moses, we always read about this tough man, right? He goes into the mountain and he gets God's law. And he comes down and he sees them with idols and he smashes the tablets. He's leading them through the wilderness. He's doing miracles. He is God's man. But before he could be greatly used of God, he was pitiful and scared. If you are finding yourself in a similar circumstance, you're just like Moses. Before God could exalt him and use him in a great way, God found him pitiful and scared. Psalm 23:4, the psalmist writes, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. David, assuming the position of a king, taking over from Saul. He was only a shepherd, but God used him in a tremendous way. How about this, Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6, where the leadership is being transitioned from Moses to Joseph. And Moses comforts the people of Israel. He says, be strong and of good courage. Do not fear nor be afraid of them. For the Lord your God is, he's the one who goes with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. One more for you. 1 Chronicles 28, verse 20. David speaking to Solomon says this, be strong and of good courage and do it. Do not fear nor be dismayed, for the Lord God, my God, will be with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you until you have finished all the work for the service of the house of the Lord. Again, notice, these are just four verses or four passages. But over and over again in the Bible, we see men and women who are fearful, not knowing about the circumstances that they're going to face. But God shows up. He does a great work in their life. He assures them. Their fear is turned into faith. If you are facing fear today, discouragement, know that God is going to be there for you. He's got to make sure that you have faith to carry on. Have you ever thought about the fact that fear is a part of human nature? Have you ever thought about that? It's amazing that if you're sitting at home watching television, and you're here in the United States, and you can see something happening on the other side of the world, thousands and thousands of miles away, and there's like a terrorist attack that happens overseas. What happens? There's fear that comes, right? What's the question that goes to your mind? Is it going to happen here? You know, what's going on? You know, there's fear that happens. But you know what I've thought about even more than terrorism and all these other things? When we face fear, we're always tempted to look at it from the earthly perspective, right? And we are consumed with the earthly perspective, and we lose focus of the heavenly perspective. And I think it's a challenge for every single one of us. Is that when there's something that comes into your life, stop completely focusing on what's in front of you and keep your eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. He says to him, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to you Mary your wife. Why? For that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. What is significant about this is, number one, this was a miraculous and supernatural act. Number two, it is consistent with God's character to do things that are beyond scientific explanation. And number three, it is not Mary that is saying this, it is the angel. It is the angel that attests to this miracle. What is inside of you? It is conceived of the Holy Spirit, a supernatural act. Now folks, I want you to think about something. There are many skeptics and people who are not believers who will say, you know what? The Bible cannot be trusted because it's a book that focuses on the supernatural aspect. For instance, you know, they say when it comes to creation, they say nothing can just come, you know, something just can't come out of nothing, right? That's their view, whatever. But when you think about the Bible is not anti-science. Sometimes God just simply intervenes within the scientific realm. For example, I'll give you an idea about this, how this works. And when you think about miracles, say an apple is falling from a tree, right? And when it starts to fall, what is that called? What is causing it to fall? It starts with the letter G. Gravity. Very good, right? Now, for instance, if as that apple is falling, I reach out and I grab it as it's about to fall, does it negate the fact that gravity exists? No, it doesn't. What I've done is I've simply interfered in the process. And when you think about scripture, when you think about miracles, and when you think about the supernatural, God is not against science. He simply interferes within the realm of science. It is the same when you think about what happens to Mary. What is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. God has done this. He is more than capable of doing so. And so this angel comes to him and he says, do not be afraid, because she has not done something scandalous. What is inside of her is of the Holy Spirit. And here's how else he assures her. He says this: and she will bring forth a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Here's what's significant about Jesus' name. A couple things here. Number one is that Jesus is a Hebrew form of the word from the Old Testament, Joshua. Joshua's name means Jehovah will save. Not just that, but not only was Jesus a testimony of God's salvation, he himself would be that salvation. It is through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ that men would have eternal life. He says to him, Joseph, don't be afraid. What is conceived of her is of the Holy Spirit. But not just that. Here is the Savior of the world, and you are going to have the privilege of being Jesus' earthly father. Guys, how many of you would love that responsibility? Right? How many of you would love the responsibility of being the physical, earthly father of Jesus? I'd be like, I'm passing right now, okay? Because I'm not going to have my son correcting my adult daughters. Never mind. Okay. So he assures him and he says, what's conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit, and she's going to bring forth a son, and Jehovah is going to save. This child that is going to be born is going to grant eternal life and salvation. This is the life that has been promised in the Old Testament is being fulfilled, Joseph, through you. I love this quote by Sidwell Baxter. He says this. He says, fundamentally, our Lord's message was himself. He did not come merely to preach a gospel. He himself is that gospel. He did not come merely to give bread. He said, I am the bread. He did not come merely to shed light. He said, I am the light. He did not come merely to show the door. He said, I am the door. He did not come merely to name a shepherd. He said, I am the shepherd. And he did not come merely to point the way. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Joseph had the responsibility of being the earthly father of Jesus Christ. He says, do not be afraid. God is working out his purposes in you and through you. And what is this Jesus going to do? You know what amazes me about Christmas time is that all of us get wrapped up in the festivities, right? We're probably panicking, wondering what gifts to get people this week. You know, we're wondering, you know, put up the last piece of decoration. And you even look at our culture today, when you go to the department stores, they've completely lost track of what Christmas is about. Christmas is not about, you know, all the things that we see around us. It's about the Son of God, Jesus Christ, putting on humanity. And what is Christmas about? What is the central message? What is the central theme of this season? He says, he will bring forth a son, you shall call his name Jesus. And what is he going to do? For he will save his people from their sins. Can you imagine going into Macy's or going into JCPenney and saying, excuse me folks, I just want to tell you something. I know you're here for Christmas, but I want you to know that Christmas is because of sin. You're like, what is wrong with you, man? Why are you putting a damper on my Christmas holiday? What's going on with you? But that is the message. Jesus Christ has come. Why? Because he will save his people from their sins. Now notice in this verse, in verse 21, the phrase, he will save his people from their sins. Let me give you, share with you a few things here. In context, it's a reference to the nation of Israel, to the people of Israel. Why? Because the Messiah would come through that lineage, through the people of Israel. But not just that, they were anticipating, they were waiting for the Messiah. But second, in a general sense, it is a salvation for all human beings. This Son, the Son of God, will come and rescue people from their sins. Here's what's interesting about the phrase sins in this passage, too, especially when you understand from a Jewish mindset, is you got to think about the Old Testament sacrifices. Sacrifices in the Old Testament could not atone for the sins of the people. You read Leviticus chapter 16, you read about the role of the high priest, where once a year, on the Day of Atonement, and it was referred to as Yom Kippur, he would go into the Holy of Holies, and he would sprinkle blood on the mercy seat, the Ark of the Covenant, which signified God's presence with man. And they would do this year after year after year, not having any type of hope for the forgiveness of sins. It was merely a picture. It was merely a symbol to show of the Messiah that was to come. Notice what Hebrews chapter 10 says, verses 3 and 4. For the law, having a shadow of the good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never, with these same sacrifices which they offer continually, year by year, make those who approach perfect. For then would they have not ceased to be offered. For the worshippers, once purified, would have no more consciousness of sins. But in those sacrifices, there is a reminder of sins every year, for it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats could take away sins. But what is the author of Hebrews trying to say? He's trying to say if sacrifice was good enough, there would be no need for Jesus Christ to come and step into humanity. He's saying what they did over and over again is that they would have these sacrifices, and to them it was a picture of their sins. Remember in the Garden of Eden in Genesis chapter 3, when Adam and Eve sinned, how does God clothe them? He clothes them through the sacrifice of an animal. And so you have these people throughout the Old Testament who had no hope. All they would do is tell the priest and he would go and offer sacrifices on their behalf. But Jesus Christ, when he steps on the scene and he dies on the cross, he is the perfect sacrifice. He is the perfect Lamb of God. He alone can satisfy the wrath of God. Do you realize that if you sit here today and you have not trusted in Christ and have received the forgiveness of sins, the Bible says that the wrath of God is on you and abides on you?
Yeah.
That's amazing. Why would you prolong it further? Why can't you just simply sit here and look and say, you know what, that's right. Because there is nothing I can do within my own merit to satisfy the wrath of God, because God is only pleased with the sacrifice of His Son. The blood of bulls and goats couldn't do it. Church attendance can't do it. Giving to church won't do it. Listening to spiritual songs won't do it. It is only through the blood of Jesus Christ. Romans 3:23 says this: For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Notice there again, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You know what's amazing about that verse? Is that when we look in our communities, we find people that are good people, right? We find good people that are moral people. You know, they do the right things, they do good things, they give charitably, all of these things, right? But when you think about these folks and then you look, watch television, you see people that get arrested, that are thrown in prison, that are criminals. You know what the Bible is trying to say? The Bible is saying that criminal that you watch on television, that person that you see sitting in a prison cell, that person that you see before a judge, is equally guilty before God as the moral person in your neighborhood. Isn't that incredible? That all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and all are in need of salvation. We have such a tendency to view ourselves through our own eyes and think we're better than someone else. But when God sees us, He sees sinners. And every one of us are equally responsible for the death of Jesus Christ because of our sin. Look at what Charles Spurgeon says. Charles Spurgeon says this: God would not have given him a name of secondary value. He's talking about Jesus' name. Or about which there would be a trace of dishonor. The name is the highest, brightest, and noblest of names. It is the glory of our Lord to be a Savior. Joshua of old was a Savior. Gideon was a Savior. David was a Savior. But the title is given to our Lord above all others because He is a Savior in a sense in which no one else is or can be. He saves His people from their sins. The name of Jesus is to be adored. So first thing we see is that a purpose is revealed. Number two, a prophecy confirmed. A prophecy confirmed, verses 22 and 23. Look at what it says. For all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the Lord through the prophet, saying, Behold, the virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated, God with us. You know what Matthew is trying to show? Matthew is trying to show that this prediction of this lady conceiving of the Holy Spirit was predicted in the book of Isaiah. Not just that, Isaiah 7:14 says this, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Now folks, I want you to think about how incredible it is when you look at prophecy in Scripture. Notice when this prophecy in Isaiah 7:14 was written. The book of Isaiah was written between 701 and 681 BC. Notice in the Old Testament, it works its way from the largest number back to the smallest number. So 600 to 700 years before the time of Christ, Isaiah prophesied that there would be someone who would conceive of the Holy Spirit, and his name would be Emmanuel. Now ask yourself this question. Why would God give this message to Isaiah? Why give something 700 years before? What is the purpose? What is the point? Why couldn't God just show up in the New Testament and say, "Hey, here am I, I'm God, believe in me"? Remember again, the Jewish people adored and they had great reverence for the Old Testament. But there was something interesting that was happening in the time of Isaiah. Look at a little bit of this history, and this will help explain what I'm referring to. So the question is, what was happening in the book of Isaiah that caused the prophecy to be proclaimed? Remember, in the time of Isaiah, the kingdoms are divided. You have Israel and you have Judah. Israel being part of the northern kingdom, and you have Judah being part of the southern kingdom. But look at what was happening. Number one, King Ahaz was the son of King Uzziah. But look at what happened. He ruled Judah, which is in the south. Razan, okay, what a great name to have, ruled Syria. And Pekah was king of Israel. Okay, so that's the first one. Number two, Ahaz was a wicked king who filled Jerusalem with idols and violated God's law. Ahaz was a wicked king. Number three, Razan and Pekah wanted to replace Ahaz with a king who would do their bidding. Number four, Ahaz was fearful and plundered the temple of gold and silver and sent it to king of Assyria. The Assyrians were a very strong nation. And basically what he was trying to do, Ahaz, was trying to bribe this Assyrian king. So Isaiah comes to Ahaz and tells him that even though they're fearful of the Assyrians and even though they would be carried into captivity, the line of Jesus Christ would not be destroyed. You know what's significant about what happens in Isaiah and what happens throughout the rest of the Old Testament? Is we find that Satan is constantly trying to destroy the lineage of Jesus Christ. Do you notice that? What happens in Genesis chapter 3 that's alarming, what that's significant, is not only does God issue a verdict on sin, but he also says that the seed of the woman would crush the head of the serpent. Who's the seed of the woman? It's a reference to Jesus Christ. And when you look at the Old Testament, there are circumstances and situations that where the people of Israel could have been destroyed. But what was God doing? Not only was he preserving them, but he was preserving the line to Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? A prophecy that was taking place, a prophecy that was confirmed. And Isaiah even makes this statement. He says this. He says, Emmanuel means God with us. Even more than a descriptive sense, it is used in the literal sense. God with us. Remember when I started the Gospel of John, our series on Sunday mornings, John makes a very important, says an important thing about Jesus Christ. He says this, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And behold, we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." Remember now, Isaiah is saying, Emmanuel, God with us. John chapter 1 says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Remember what the root of the word dwelt was? It literally means, and the Word tabernacled among us. Just like in the Old Testament where the people of Israel were walking through in tabernacles and they would lodge. And then they would get up and then they would go into the tabernacle and offer sacrifices. Matthew is trying to tell us, John is trying to tell us, that God who was out there, he dwelt among us. Folks, that is the difference between Christianity and every other religion in the world today, is that God comes down to us. Man. If you've ever taken time to visit an Eastern nation, whether it's Hinduism, whether it's Buddhism, whether it's Islam, notice that you always have to make some type of pilgrimage to God. If you go to a Hindu country like India, there's always these great and elaborate steps where you have to make your way to the gods, you have to sacrifice to them, you have to bring food for them. Every other religion in the world tells you that you need to try your best to get to God. But we have the only worldview, the only religion, the only true faith says that there is no way that we can ever go to God. God says, I'm coming down to you. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. You know what's significant about that? Is that we think, okay, Jesus ascended and he went into heaven and he's seated at the right hand of the Father. Folks, the Holy Spirit resides within me. You know who the tabernacle is now? This is scary. Wait for it. It's you and I. You and I are the tabernacle and the Holy Spirit dwells within us. That is absolutely scary. God, are you sure you want to dwell within me? Look at how sinful and messed up I am, but God says, not only did I come to this earth, and not only did I die, not only did I rise from the dead, and I'm ascended to the Father's house, but I'm also residing within you. Lastly, verse 24 and 25, there is a promise realized. A promise realized. Verse 24, then Joseph, being aroused from his sleep, did as the angel of the Lord commanded him, and took to him his wife. Now I read that, and I'm thinking to myself, now how exactly did he do this? You know, he goes to sleep, he has this dream, and he wakes up and says, okay, I'm ready to get married. I'm not quite sure it happened like that. You know, he probably was in a pretty deep sleep, right? Everyone, there's some of you that I bet when you wake up in the morning, if somebody even utters a word to you, there's like a lion that roars, okay? Now there's some people that can wake up pretty good in the morning, early in the morning, doesn't matter, you're ready to go. But some people you approach like your spouse and like, oh, okay, sorry, you know, sorry, here's three cups of coffee. So he gets up from his sleep, but I'm pretty sure he was like, you know what, God has confirmed this. He's given me a dream. I'm going to be faithful, I'm going to obey. And he goes to Mary and he takes her as his wife. All six references of the words from sleep are used in Matthew regarding Jesus Christ. Think about this. God will do whatever it takes to move us from fear to faith. God will do whatever it takes to move us from fear to faith. Now, I want you to think about something else regarding Joseph. Joseph's a just man. He wants to put her away privately. He has this dream. Angel says, don't do it. There's something great and significant about this child. But I want you to think about, what do you think it was like in that town, in that community, to have a woman walking around pregnant with Joseph? People talking, right? You know that happens. Folks, there's people in our community like that. They're like, I can't believe, you know, she got pregnant. She's not even married. Folks, we're all sinners. Next time you see something like that and you're tempted to utter a word of discouragement, I think you should go up to them and say, hey, I'm going to help you in love on you. Because I guarantee you, if Mary and Joseph were living in our communities, we would talk about them too. Imagine Joseph having to walk around and people talking. You know what's interesting? If you read John chapter 8, go read John chapter 8 when you get home. They basically call Jesus Christ illegitimate. The Pharisees say to Jesus, we know who our Father is. How about you? You know what that tells me? Is that these events were talked about throughout the ministry and life of Jesus Christ. But Joseph, being a just man, obeys. And what's significant, I'll close with this, verse 25. And did not know her till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Now, why would Matthew write that? Because he knew that people would distort some type of information here. And I want to close with some very important points regarding this, okay? Number one, Mary and Joseph did not consummate their marriage until Jesus was born. Why does Matthew tell us this? Because what is conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. Joseph is not Jesus' dad. He's only in terms of the legal sense. But you say to yourself, well, Dave, why exactly are you telling us about this? What's so significant about this? Here's what it is. And you know, of course, I have to be sensitive because we're where we're meeting, but we'll say it anyways. It contradicts the Roman Catholic teaching and the perpetual virginity, not of Jesus, of Mary. That's the title, virginity of Mary. They say that she stayed a virgin for the rest of her life. That's what they believe, okay? And I want to share with you some other views here. You say to yourself, so someone says to you, well, she stayed a virgin for the rest of her life. Well, what does the Bible say? Look at Matthew chapter 13, verses 55 and 56. When they're talking about Jesus, they say, is this not the carpenter's son? Okay, that's fine. You must conceive of the Holy Spirit. Is not his mother called Mary? And his brothers, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas. And his sisters, are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? Do you see why this teaching is so important? Mary was a sinner just like every single one of us. Listen to this quote here. This is an unbiblical doctrine which did not appear earlier than the 5th century after Jesus. It should be placed with the dogmas of Mary's Immaculate Conception, Assumption into Heaven, and present role as a mediator for believers. Each one of these is man's invention meant to exalt Mary in an unbiblical manner. Folks, you see this happening all around you, right? Mary was perfect. Mary stayed a virgin for the rest of her life. Mary is a mediator. Folks, what does the Bible say? Who's our mediator? Jesus Christ.
Man.
Sound doctrine really does matter. The question is, not my opinion, but what does the Bible really have to say? Mary was just a vessel that was used to fulfill God's purposes. Last quote is this. This emphasized that Jesus was conceived miraculously. Matthew wants to make Jesus' virginal conception quite unambiguous, for he adds that Joseph did not have sexual union with Mary until she gave birth to Jesus. There's details, there's things that they're adding in there to make sure that we are not confused. But when people start to add dogmas and creeds and they start to add things to the Word of God, that's where we get false teachings and false books. Here's what God's message was to Joseph. Joseph, understand that you're fearful, understand that you're scared, but know that God's word is true. Understand that God has a purpose, that God is going to carry out that purpose, and what he has revealed is not false, but it is the full truth and nothing but the truth. You can trust in God. What are the implications for you today, this Christmas? And even as you go into the new year, you know what it is? You can trust in God's word. You can have circumstances and situations where you are faced with fear, but God will do whatever it takes to turn your fear into faith. Let's be honest, every single one of us has been at a point where we're just like, man, I just give up. I know I have. I feel like I'm like that once a week, right? Every one of us are like, I just give up. But you know what? God will do whatever it takes. You know why? Because he's your father. And a father will look over his children and watch his children. If you face fear, if you face uncomfortable circumstances and situations, look at Joseph's life. He could have put her away privately, but God assured him, God encouraged him. And he was merely a vessel that God used for his purpose and his glory, because all the attention was on Jesus Christ. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, I thank you again that we have had this time together this morning, where we get to sing about a Savior who came to this earth, who lived a sinless life, who lived a perfect life, suffered at the hands of man, died on the cross, but rose victoriously. Father, there is no other hope for us. It is Jesus Christ alone. And I thank you that you sent him and that we have the opportunity to trust him as our Savior. Lord, I do pray that as we go into this week, and actually every single day, Lord, that we would not make the Christmas season into an idol where we just celebrate it once a year, Father, but I pray that every single day we would be reminded of who you are, your goodness, your love, and your faithfulness towards us. Father, I do pray again for families here, Lord, that have loved ones that are struggling, that are going through difficult times. Father, I pray that you would just be with them, be a source of love and comfort and compassion towards them. And Father, for all of us who are looking forward to the new year, I pray that we would carry our faith before our fears, Father, and I pray that we would learn to trust you with everything that we have. Father, ultimately, that all the honor, praise, and glory would go to you. We love you, and we praise you, for I ask you all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we take time to dismiss this, before we dismiss this morning, and I know you're going to be headed out of here, there's a couple things I want to remind you of. First of all, for all of you that stayed after church service a couple weeks ago to help with the Good News Club in assembling those packages for those children, I want to greatly thank you, and I appreciate it. And even for those of you that brought supplies in, it was a tremendous help. So thank you very much for doing that. Also, for the Christmas dinner, we were packed out. We had a great time. But if you helped out with the Christmas dinner, can you please stand real quick so we can recognize you? And I know who you are, but so instead of me calling you out, you might as well just do it right now, okay? So if you helped out with the Christmas dinner, just please stand up real quick, and we want to say a word of appreciation to you right now, okay? Michelle, you, okay. Michelle, Daniel, where are you? You're shy, okay? Kathy's over there. It was very well decorated. It was very well done. We had a great time of fellowship, so thank you, everyone who did that. Also, thank you, everyone who brought in gifts for needy families in the area. That was a tremendous encouragement, so may the Lord bless you for doing that. Also, last note is, and the notes are in the bulletin for announcements, but our printed directories are available. They're at the welcome table, so please stop by if you haven't received some already, but please use that so you can pray for fellow members, get in touch with them, and know who everyone is. So it's towards the back. Anyways, let's stand as we dismiss with a word of prayer. Harvey, would you mind coming and closing us out, please?
Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for all the great things that you're doing for us in this holiday season. We thank you so much for all the great events that you're doing through our church and for the Good News Club and for the gathering and just all the different services, Matthew 25 Ministry, so much stuff you're doing. With our church. And we thank you so much that, first, when Joseph is going through this time of fear and just being afraid of what's next, I know that many of us are going through stages in our life where we might not know what's next, and we just pray that you would give us the faith to go up against those challenges and those mysterious times in our lives and give us the boldness and the blessing of what you have for our future. So we thank you for this time in the holiday season that we are reminded of Christ and for the reason of this Christmas season. So we thank you so much for that, and thank you. And all these things we ask in your name. Amen.